Hi, everyone. As you're coming in, I want everyone to dance their mood. So as you're coming in, let's do it. Come on. Just us. I'm pretty excited, so I'm going to do some headbanging. Where's your jazz hands, Matt? We were victims all night. The chemical, physical, kryptonite. I love it! Maybe some voguing? Finger dancing? No? Maybe this. I'm like, no more work. Let's do the X. Say fast. Ah, you know it. So I like to turn around. If everyone's got like a stand-up desk, maybe. Let's do that. Yeah, there you go, Matt. Love it. For those just joining us, let's do a little dance your mood, and then we'll get started. Oh, we got still black people coming. You're popular, Matt. I know. You got all the people still coming. All right. Thank you, everyone. And those of you. Oh, we got still people coming. Still coming. All right. Thank you for those who danced their mood with us. So, like, getting everyone up and about. I had to, you know. Stand up my desk here. I've been sitting all day. I'm sure a lot of you have. Shake it off. Let's get started here. All right. We still got people coming. I was just telling Matt he's very popular. So. All right. So I just want to thank everyone for still coming. All right. So. All right. Let's do that. And I want to just get still people coming. I'm going to introduce Matt to you all today. I want to thank everyone for joining us in our butter mixer. I have known Matt, it feels like forever, but I think it's been a couple years now, maybe 2 or 3 years. And I actually discovered him, I think his book, which I actually have on my desk.
You got a copy.
See all those flags? Look at that. Strategy, and I'm gonna link his website for you in the chat here in a little bit. That's actually how I first got connected with Matt. I think I just like stalked him on LinkedIn, maybe, and then, that's how I got connected with him. And he's got a background in brand strategy. He's a brand consultant, and so all of this brand strategy and archetype knowledge bombs you're gonna get today, like this is gold. I'm glad you are here. And especially as a facilitator community here, you know, we're all building our own facilitator brand. Some might be facilitators in the room, others might be brand strategists, but we all have maybe a brand or a personal brand that we're building. And there's going to be so much knowledge coming out of Matt today. I just know it. Not to put you on the spot there.
Stuff will be coming out, whether it's knowledge or not, we'll have to find out together. But I'll do my best, folks.
All right, so I'm going to go ahead and pass it over to Matt, and I believe, there you go, and
all right,
get started.
Well, thank you, Rachel. I said to Rachel, folks, I said, right, that warm-up, right, she said, what sort of warm-up shall I do? What do you call it, Rachel, when people come in? What's it called?
A check-in, or ice melters.
There we are, one of those. And I said, she said, what can we do? I said, Rach, just pick the craziest thing you can think of. So at the time, it was the dance that you could do, and so that's what we're doing. Well, folks, it's an absolute honor to be invited by Butter and Rachel to kind of collaborate to give you today's session. As Rachel says, like, I'm a brand strategist. I do a lot of work with leadership teams. And so facilitation is a core part of what I do. I've got a bit of a deck, which I'm going to walk us through, but don't think it's just going to be me talking at you the whole time. We're going to have some workshops and some exercises throughout. And hopefully, you know, we're going to sort of play with the tools, play with some tools, play with some ideas, play with some concepts. I'm going to share with you today, perhaps one of the most powerful tools in the toolkit, I believe. Oh, hang on, I'm sharing the wrong thing. One second. This one, which is the concept around archetypes. And we'll get into what they are and why they're useful and how I use them and how you can begin to use them if you haven't done so already. In just a few moments, a couple of kind of core things. What's the objective of our session together? So I thought, well, let's set the bar quite high. Let's try and aim high. First of all, I want to share some ideas with you, as we've said, around archetypes, and show you how hopefully you can begin to use those in brand building, not only your personal brand, but if you also work with leadership teams, if you create marketing campaigns, creative stuff, if you create product, you'll find that hopefully what I'm going to share with you will be useful. The next thing hopefully we're going to do is discover some principles you can deploy in your work, hopefully from tomorrow morning. And also, I'd love for you all to begin to connect together and share together, so we'll get to know each other a little bit along the way. So let's get into it. What are some little definitions? I just wanted to sort of explain how I use archetypes, because I really like to start from the beginning just to make sure everybody's on the same page from my brand perspective. So first of all, what is a brand? Well, I define brand as the meaning people attach to us and our offer. So the brand is the meaning that other people attach to us. It's the meaning that's in their hearts and minds. And the game that I'm in, and I think we're all in to some extent, is this idea of branding. Which is the management of that meaning. So whether you're employed, whether you run a business, whether you're a freelancer, whether you're an agency, whether you're in a corporate, to my mind, it doesn't really matter. We all have to manage the way that we show up to others. And if we're doing that thoughtfully, then I think strategically we're in a better place than if we kind of allow that to just happen haphazardly. And so that brings us on to the third little circle there, which is the idea of personal branding, which is where we really intentionally manage the meaning that we want others to attach to us. This isn't about being manipulative or in any way inauthentic. This is just about choosing relevant things and relevant ways of showing up, so that authentic part of ourselves, which we need others to understand about us, can. And so as we put on the screen there, the first step of managing meaning is, in fact, to define it. And archetypes are going to help us define it. Now, there we are. Is that you, Rachel? Is that some other random person doing it? I like
that's
this.
Totally me.
It's give me more totally cheers me. And claps. It encourages me as we go through. What I was going to do was, there we go. Before we get into archetypes, there's one thing I wanted to sort of drop and share with you, which I think hopefully will be helpful. And it's not easy. This looks easy, but it's actually quite tricky, particularly when we try and look at ourselves and to do. But I've got four, what I call four big brand questions. And if you've got my book that Rachel mentioned, that they're covered in that book. But in essence, they're very simple. It's a bit, you know, bit ripped off from Simon Sinek's Golden Circle. But if you're aware of what that is, but let me explain it very briefly. So the big questions really are, why do we exist beyond making money? Like, I think that's quite a powerful question for us to answer. Who do we exist to serve? If the meaning that we want to portray has to land in somebody's mind, who is that person? Who are we most wanting to position ourselves effectively towards to serve? What is our offer? You know, what is it that we're wanting them to know, and what do we want to offer them? And finally, how will we show up for them? Now, archetypes that we're going to come on to in a minute is going to live in that how box. I think, you know, how we do what we do, the mission, etc., is you could define that. But the way that you do it, the personality that you want to sort of inject into your work, that comes up in archetypes, and that comes up in the how. Now, before we look at archetypes, to kind of get us in the mood, to kind of get things started, what we're going to do is we're going to have a play with my little tool here. So I've got a little exercise, which I'm hoping you'll all be prepared and happy to kind of jump into. I mean, we're in a butter kind of facilitated room here. So you're going to have to roll up your sleeves and get going. We've got a very simple workshop. I'm going to ping over you in a second to the mural, which I've set up, which is basically a collaborative workboarding space if you've not used it before. And you're going to grab a box, which I'm going to show you. There's going to be tons of boxes on the screen. I want you to grab one, put your name in, and detail your why, who, and what. So let me do that right now. I'm going to replace that in there, and you should start to see, I'm hoping everybody can get in. Me and Rach did test this before. Hang on, let me zoom out. You can
see, and just put your name and hit enter as a visitor. You're not going to have to put your email. Don't worry about that. Just put your name and then click enter as a visitor. And I put a screenshot in the chat.
Perfect. So, you know, I'm going to give you about eight minutes to kind of do this. Well, maybe even less, see how you get on. So just pick a box. If you see that you're in an area or a zone and somebody else's name is in the little circle in the top left, just move on to another one. If you want to navigate around, you can see in your screen, in the frame, there's a little plus minus zoom in and out section. I'm sure most of us have used tools like this by now. So if you're kind of wondering what on earth, where am I, maybe zoom out. Little tip I like to use is to you can just scroll around and you can sort of see what's going on. If you want to move around, this little hand tool in the bottom right hand side, so you can click and grab around the page. That can be quite helpful. If you click on that hand, you can then click and grab around and find yourself somewhere to add your details. So the task is jump in, add your name, try and add a why, a who, and a what. Now, if you're not sure, if you're thinking, Matt, wow, this is a big question to start off with, I get it's not always easy. Just do your best. It's not too serious. I'm not going to kind of upset, you know, pick on you too much. I'm quite a nice guy, really, aren't I, Rach? I try my best.
You're a fantastic guy. And we've actually got about 40 people in the room. So everyone, there should be about 40 on here, right, Matt? So everyone.
There should be. It might be hard to find a corner. I don't know how many I put in. I didn't know how many people to expect, to be honest, but I think there's there's about 50 in there. There's a 50.
Oh, there we go. We got plenty.
Yeah.
Do you want me to go ahead and start the timer, Matt?
Oh, that's a great shout. Yes, please. Let's do that.
All right. So we're going to get about 8 minutes to do this. If you have any questions, just drop them in the chat. We'll be monitoring them and we can answer.
Brilliant.
Hey, Matt, are you talking? Because you're on mute.
I love that. I was like saying loads of exciting stuff. I mean, sharing loads of wisdom. There it was. You missed it.
I was like, you look like you're talking. Let's get you off mute. Go ahead. Now share those wisdom. We've got about five. 5 minutes left on the timer. I've muted the timer music, so you can go ahead and talk.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, I'm absolutely blown away by some of the things here, really enjoying what people are putting in. Really good. I was going to say, there was one here, I loved Erica. Erica's was pretty cool. To help people, communities, and organizations be at their best so that together we may contribute to making the world a better place. Nice work, nice work. There's loads of other good stuff on there. Well done to anyone who's finished. Brian, I can see you're just finishing yours. Hector, great work. Loving that. If you've finished yours, have a look at what some of the other folks are saying as well. Is a little thought, just to see how other people have put their why, who, and what down. Because it's very insightful.
We had a question in the chat if they should be filling in the reasons or just the why. I think just the why, right?
Yeah, the archetype and the reasons will come later, but I'm loving the enthusiasm there. So thank you.
I'm glad I got you off mute there, because I was like, are you having like a monologue? What's happening over there?
I also see in here, Riggs, that Kreiser has asked a question which I think is super interesting. She said, why drives everything we do and what we do? Why do you think, what do you think the reason is that people struggle with defining and understanding their why? I think that's a really interesting question. I think it's really tough sometimes to realize why you do what you do. I think we kind of start doing stuff and we lose sight of why this is really important, and we find it really hard to articulate it because we're so busy just doing it all the time. And so my personal view is that that we do know our why. It's tucked deep down in our hearts, right? It just needs prizing out and being able to articulate well. And that is really tough. And you know, as a brand strategist, I often find that when I'm working with leadership teams, particularly, the hardest bit is the purpose, when we are trying to align all of them together around something really succinct and clear and simple. But it's even harder, my view is when you're working with individuals. So I do work, you know, coaching and work with CEOs and so on, and it's really, really tough. But you can get it, folks, and you will find it. And I can see here, there's some here, like Mike, I love yours, Mike. I help companies and teams live their values. You know, that's his purpose. That's why he does what he does. He does it to do that. You could follow that up with a, well, why do you do that, Mike? But sometimes you don't need to. Sometimes just keep it, don't overthink it. Keep it simple, I think. Sometimes we try and go too crazy with these things. I like Sherry's one. Joy and fun to people, people's work and lives. You know, that's why she does it. She brings joy and fun. That's what she loves to do. So really great stuff. So it looks like some folks are completely done. Others are still kind of coming through there. I wonder, I'm having a quick look here, whether I might call this quits early, because it looks like most people have done it. You're a super smart group. So I am actually, Rach, can I do that? Am I allowed to do that? I'm a facilitator.
You're allowed to do whatever you want.
I'm going to do it. How do I stop this time? Can you stop it for us? Let's just stop it. People have done a great job. This is great. I underestimated everybody. So fantastic job, folks. So I'm going to pick on a few people. I said I wouldn't pick on you fully, but I'm going to pick on a few people. So I tell you what, is there anyone that wants to volunteer? Volunteer. How do they put their hands up, Rachel? Would you like to explain to them?
So you can see the little queue over. Yeah, we've got first.
Antonio. Come on, Antonio. Give us your why, who, and what as quick as you can. Nope.
You got to come off mute. Where are you? Oh, nope. Okay. We'll go to Mick.
Okay. Someone else?
Yeah. Hey, thanks. My name's Mick. Thanks so much for this, Matt. You mentioned mine. I help companies and teams live their values. I wanted to get into like action steps and like I help them take action and do practices. And but it's like, no. The point is that they actually live by their values. The who I serve is trickier to me at this moment, but I'm definitely only interested in serving people who actually want to grow and develop. I'm not going to drag anybody through like how to support their employees or like build good retention practices or help people with their personal development. So that's that. And what I offer are workshops and customized trainings and just consulting. in psychological safety, management effectiveness, and then career development, conversations, and all the associated sort of opportunities that exist there.
Nice. Nice to get to know you, Mick. Great input. Thank you so much. You'll do well, I think, as we go through the process, hopefully. So it's a great job. Anyone else? Who's next?
We have Erica next.
I can go.
Oh, my good friend, Erica. How are you?
Hello. I'm great. So I give voice and advocate for those who exist in the margins, and that's on an individual level or even as like an organization. And the folks that I support are small business owners, people in the BIPOC and LGBTQ plus communities, and female-owned business leaders. And I help them with brand strategy and marketing strategy.
Nice, nice, fantastic. Great to connect, Erica. I think we've been in touch a few times, but it's lovely to actually see you and speak to you. So great stuff. Thank you for articulating that. Anyone else? I see Antonio's come on again, but he just mentioned he couldn't speak. Can he now speak?
No, he said he can speak now. So I'm going to go ahead.
Come on in, Antonio.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, welcome.
Yes, good. I went to my Bluetooth headset so that I can go to another room. Thank you. So really excited to be here, that's the first thing. So I will share my why. I'm here to help entrepreneurs achieve their goals and make their dreams come true so that they can use their expertise to transform their audience lives.
Love it. Love it. That's love nice. It. I love it.
Now,
so what's the what? You've said the who, entrepreneurs.
The who is a bit, I could be a bit more specific, entrepreneurs who are truly passionate about their project and the impact they create in the world. And the what in this case will be building a project that they can sustain the passion for that project without feeling burnt, broke, or demotivated.
Nice. So, love it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Great work. All right. Well, thank you very much. So, hopefully, that was really good. So thanks for those three that volunteered. And it's really, really good. So I've just seen we've got most people have managed to do this. A couple of people are still working on it. It is tough. It is really tough to do that. But if you've done, obviously, some of you have taken some time out already to probably think that through in the past. If you haven't, if this is the first time you're grappling with some of these questions, you've got to take the time, I would suggest. Do the thinking, do the work, get that down. Because without knowing some of the answers to those questions, your personal brand it's hard to then kind of move into a more of a strategic space to manage your personal brand. But we're doing well. We're doing well on time, and we're ready to go. Now, I'm keen to get you out of here and get into archetypes. So we are a little bit ahead, but that's good because it will give us a bit more time a bit later on. So I'm just going to give folks another sort of 30 seconds on this. And I know I'm going to be ahead of time, but I'm going to jump out and jump into something else. So you won't be able to access this for a few moments.
So Matt, we have a quick question about having access to this afterwards. I would recommend after our second activity that everyone take a screenshot of their activity square so that they have it with them. And then the recording will be available. And I didn't know if you were sharing the mural link or not, but I recommend everyone take a screenshot of their own activity after our second activity at the end.
Yeah. If anyone really needs access, I can. But to be honest, I think what you've said, Rach, is probably the best if you just take a screenshot, because I can't guarantee it'll be up there forever. All right. Okay. So on that bombshell, I'm gonna extract us out of here and carry on with my presentation, because we've got a little bit to get through now, and I'm keen to share some thoughts here. So let me just make sure I can pull this up. Great. Okay. So we ready, everybody? We're going to do this. What's the biggest problem that archetypes solve for? Now, my view of this is that they solve for clarity and consistency. And you'll see why in a minute. I particularly find them very useful to align leadership teams. This is what I do on a day-to-day basis. They become the bridge, I find, between what the boardroom thinks and then how we outwork that into creative teams and then out into customer experiences. If you use them well, they can be super powerful to help that happen. And so they bring that clarity and they can bring consistency, but they also, if you deploy them correctly, can give you flexibility so that you can kind of flex around certain situations. And I'll show you that as we go through. So they really solve for that problem. And I don't know about you, but whenever you work with multiple teams and different people within teams, the problem with people is always the people, but they're also always the solution. So you've got to work with the way that they think. You've got to give them some tools, some ideas, some ways of aligning, and archetypes help to do that. But what if you're working with an individual, like the billing for this event was about, you know, you as a freelancer or you as an employee, how you manage your meaning. Can they give you clarity and consistency as well? And my answer to that is 100% yes. Now, you're probably thinking, well, this is lovely, you're talking about all these things, but what on earth are archetypes? And I am coming to that. But before that, let me build into it. Because if brand is the meaning that people attach to you and your offering, and branding is the management of meaning, if I was to ask, well, what's the best way as human beings, just generally, how do we create meaning in our minds? What would the answer be? And the psychologists tell us that the answer, in fact, is stories. And so when you think about it, stories create meaning, and meaning ultimately can create brands. And what the same the other way around, brands can create meaning, which creates stories for customers. So I see it as a kind of a chain of thought there that you kind of need to think through. Storytelling is the way that we see ourselves. So the psychologists tell us that in adolescence, we almost write our own kind of script for our life. And this is made up of the way that we're brought up, our expectations, our dreams. And in life, if we kind of are hitting those in different areas of our life, relationships, income, whatever it might be, then we feel satisfaction. We feel like we're on track. We feel happy. But if there's an area of our life that doesn't kind of fit with our expectations, our pre-written story, if you like, then we feel dissatisfaction, we feel upset, and we look around to bring our lives back on track or to solve that problem and to heal us. If we kind of feel that we need to become somebody, then what we do is we look around for things that will support our narrative of ourselves. And archetypes really help us through. Brands sit in that space. They help us become something. And so that's why it's really important for us to think that through, at least from my perspective as a brand strategist. Now, I'm going to teach you two tools. One tool is Hero's Journey, and the second tool is going to be the archetypes. And you'll see how these all fit together beautifully in a minute. If you've done any work on story theory, you'll have come across the Hero's Journey. Why? What is it? Well, it was something that was created and documented by this chap, Joseph Campbell, in his book, The Hero with 1,000 Faces. Super thick book, really interesting stuff. He studied myths and stories throughout time, throughout history, throughout various different cultures. And he documented what he called the monomyth. And what he found was that in all stories, generally speaking, across the world, there's this really similar narrative, this story arc, and it goes like this. So on the right hand side is a bit of one of my pictorial representations of it. The hero starts in the status quo, like everything's normal, and then there's this call to adventure. Something unusual happens, you know, help me Obi-Wan Kenobi, you know, whatever. It's like something unusual, this call to adventure, but the hero kind of starts to resist it. And doesn't really want to change. They're kind of happy with it, with where they are. And then what happens is in the story, a mentor shows up and gives the hero some advice or a tool or a map or a magic wand or something. The hero doesn't really know what to do with this. They don't really want to go on this quest anyway, but they've got the thing. And the hero has taught them some information or taught them some skills. Now, as I say, the hero is kind of a bit like meh. But then something forces the hero to leave their ordinary world and to go into a special world, to travel outside of the status quo. So, you know, in The Lord of the Rings, you know, Frodo has to flee the Shire to get out because he's being chased by these horrible things, whatever they are, ring wraiths. So you get the story, yeah? Or Katniss Everdeen is you know, has to go into the Hunger Games. They're outside of the, the ordinary world and they enter the special world, whatever that might be. They're outside of their comfort zone. And so then the story takes shape. They depart. There's various trials along the way. They find people that they really kind of get on with, and they support the hero. And but they also find villains and people that stab them in the back and cause them problems. And they're sort of traveling towards what we have as the crisis there at 6 o'clock. Some asteroid needs destroying, a dragon needs to be killed, or some massive evil or danger has turned up in the story, and the hero needs to deal with that. And so they move towards it. And guess what they do? They start utilizing and using the knowledge, the wisdom, the special tool, the special magic object that the mentor originally gave them at the start of the story. Anyway, spoiler alert, because what happens is the hero actually does overcome the crisis, defeats the dragon, blows the asteroid up, lands on the moon, whatever they're doing. There's a wonderful result, and the hero usually gets some prestige, and then the hero has to return again to wherever they came from, back to Middle Earth, back to the Shire, whatever it might be. But something's changed. Because the hero usually has some sort of character flaw or some sort of problem that's been resolved through the challenges of the story. And so now they go back into their old life, but they're renewed, they're improved, and they've learned along the way. And we, as listeners and watchers of these stories, have learned and grown along the way too. And we are addicted to stories because they release in our brains all of the chemicals, the cortisone when danger pops up, the oxytocin when everything's resolved at the end, the dopamine when we've learned stuff along the way with the hero. So we, as humans, we're wired to be totally, totally connected to storytelling. And I like to simplify it. This is based on actually Aristotle, his kind of three acts, which are before the change, making the change, and the impact of the change. Now, here's the thing, folks. If that is how our brains think, and if that's what we're engaged in lots of different areas of our life all the time, why wouldn't we look at ourselves and our customers in this light? In other words, what if the customer was the hero of your story? The customer's the hero. They're about to go into a special place, and it's dangerous, and it's awkward. They're trying to solve a problem, but they don't know what to do. And we're going to show up, and we're going to show up to help them through. Now, brands show up in the customer's journey as the mentor. One mistake a lot of people make is they try and make themselves the focus of the story. It's not about you. Frankly, no one cares about you. They care about themselves and what you can do to help them through their challenges, to make them become something that they're not, to help them overcome the challenges ahead, to help them do it safer, quicker, faster, whatever it might be. And so that's what we're going to think about now. Now, before we move on, I just wanted to say, like, all popular stories, most of the major film franchises use this way of thinking. And in fact, George Lucas, obviously the creator of Star Wars, he actually referenced Joseph Campbell's work. He took that archetypal narrative, if you like, and he deployed it straight into Star Wars. Lord of the Rings, Hunger Games, Harry Potter, all of these, they all use this story arch, and they do it deliberately because we know that that's how the brain works and what excites us. And so, as we say, that's the monomyth, he called it, the single myth narrative that Joseph Campbell identified. And we, as brands, will show up there in as the mentor. Oh, crumbs, I've jumped ahead. Now, the second tool which fits into that is this idea of archetypes. So now we're going to get into it properly. So what's an archetype? Well, archetypes are initially identified by the famous psychiatrist and psychoanalyst Carl Jung, who basically defined them as forms or images of a collective nature which occur practically all over the earth as constituents of myths and at the same time individual products of the unconscious. Oh my goodness, bit of a mouthful. Let's try and unpack that just a little bit. I think one thing is helpful to know about Carl Jung is that he helped patients with who were very poor and uneducated at the time with dreams and hallucinations and madnesses, mental illnesses, in fact. Now, he was an expert in mythology and had a classical education. And one of the things that he thought was most remarkable is that some of the people he was coming into contact with would recount horrors and dreams in a way that he could see patterns between what they were saying and ancient myths in Roman and Babylonian culture. And so he was like, huh, this is strange. Like, there's some connection here. These people at the break of the 19th century who are uneducated, they have, some of them couldn't even read or write. They've never come into contact, as far as he could tell, with some of these myths, yet they have similar patterns in the way that their brains are thinking. And at the same time, there was a chap called Sigmund Freud running around the place, doing lots of lectures and talks in this space. And he was talking about the unconscious and the conscious mind. And the basic thinking was that, well, look, you know, stuff happens to us in adolescence and it goes into our unconscious. And then when we reach a situation later in life, say as an adult, and we face a situation, the unconscious mind kind of comes into the conscious. And we don't know why, but we respond a certain way to certain situations. And it's because of our experiences, our personal experiences back in the early part of our life, right? Now, Carl Jung thought, yeah, that's pretty good. But there's something underlying this, because the dreams and the hallucinations and so on that he was facing, he was like, yeah, but these people haven't individually come across those stories before. So he put forward this concept, and he mentioned it in that quote, of what he called the collective unconscious. Like, there's something super deep that connects all of us as human beings, like our human nature. And the way that we think, we're wired, our instincts are deep down in there. And so, for example, I think, like, for example, snakes. Even if a child has never seen a snake in their life, you put a snake in a room with a child and it will immediately fear that snake. But it's like, how does the child know to fear the snake, right? Why wouldn't it just, you know, think it's fine? Well, instinctively, in our collective unconscious, we have this inbuilt negative response to certain things. Spiders is another one for most people. So there's something deep down that connects us all, and we fear that. And what Carl Jung was saying is, look, they're commonly shared. There's things that are commonly shared. And he called those things, those patterns, archetypes, typical patterns which he could begin to identify. And then on top of that, you layer the unconscious and the conscious. Anyway, I probably have gone way too far into that, but I get a bit nerded out by these things. And hopefully some of you will have found that interesting. But the point here is that these archetypes, which are, they're amplified in stories. And so there's particular types of personalities and ways that we respond, which are amplified in stories. Now we've got to fast forward about to the year about 2000, where the wonderful Margaret Mark and Carol S. Pearson wrote this book called The Hero and the Outlaw, which I've got somewhere around. I don't know where it is. Oh, there it is. There, this book here. It's a pretty thick book, pretty boring if you don't like books. So I'll save you a little bit of time. If you do get it, definitely read the first chapter. It's pretty cool. What they did is they took Carl Jung's work. They did their own research around myths through time. And then they deployed current psychological thinking around customer motivations. And they put a brand lens upon it. And so what Margaret Mark and Carol S. Pearson, this is a little quote from their book, said, brand is a repository, not merely of functional characteristics, but of meaning and value. But if we are to identify and effectively leverage the essential elements or immutables of our brands, we must become fluent in the visual and verbal language of archetypes. It turns out that the way that we think can be and the way that we buy can be influenced by archetypal patterns. Now, if you want to know more and you want to get deep into this subject, I have a good friend of mine called Jacob Cass from Australia, and that's not his fault, by the way. And me and he, we run a bit of a little podcast called Just Branding, and we actually interviewed Carol Pearson a while back. So I think Rachel's got the link for that.
Yep, it's already in the chat. Perfect. And if you check your pinned messages, you can find all the resources and links.
Awesome. So you can check that out to your heart's content. Now, what I really want to say, though, is just taking it back to us and our workshop today, is that we're going to think about the customer as being the hero in our story. And we're going to think about how we show up as the mentor, because if we show up as an archetypal character, this can do a number of things for us. First of all, it can give us a framework to help and tell better stories. It can also help us communicate quicker, humanize our brand, connect more deeply with the audience because they'll understand emotionally what we're about, bring alignment, and elevate meaning. Ultimately, why you should use archetypes as a brand a brand person or as an individual is they'll help you manage your meaning. So I'm going to whiz through these 12 archetypes. Now, I'm over time on this section, but, and I knew I'd get excited. I've gone way too deep. But what I would really like you to do is, in a minute, we're going to do an exercise where we're going to get you all to identify a primary archetype and what we're going to call a secondary archetype. And we can talk that through in a minute. I'm going to run you through these real quick. Obviously, we can go super deep on this, but just have a little look at these and think, well, which archetype might I be when I show up as that mentor for the hero, my customer in the story? You know, how should I show up? How might I show up? And could I adopt or at least kind of use this as a framework to articulate meaning? So here we go. We've got the caregiver, which is kind of like your Mary Poppins character. You're not your doctor, nurse, looking after other people. From a brand perspective, you might think of like the NHS in the UK, our National Health Service, or Johnson's Babies, quite famous. You know, the idea of caring and motherly care, helping others get through. The next one is the citizen. The citizen's kind of like the voice of the everyday person. They sit in, they give the voice of realism. They're a bit like Ron Weasley in Harry Potter. Like Ron doesn't want to, be the hero, but he will speak the truth. He will be the voice of reason to Harry Potter as he goes through his adventures. And a brand that does this really, really well is IKEA, who celebrate the wonderful everyday, everyday's normality. The next one, I've got a feeling we've got a few of these in the room, is the creator. The creator is kind of like your Geppetto character in Pinocchio, the person in the craft, in the workshop, crafting the next big thing. They want to give form to a vision, and they really take the tools really, really carefully and seriously. And a brand that really helps people create, you might think of Adobe or Crayola, but I've picked their Lego, which is really kind of a powerful, I've got some kids, I use spend a lot of time in Lego. So, you know, creator, creating, using our imaginations and enabling that archetypally. Lego do that really well. What about the explorer? The explorer is all about helping take people to new destinations. They want freedom and they want to discover new things. And so it's all about new experiences and helping others connect with those. So if you think of the North Face, for example, that's a brand which really does play on the explorer archetype, or Land Rover. You might think about the way that you see those ads positioned and the way that their products are positioned. It's always about getting out there. You never see a North Face advert with someone sat in an office. It's just not a thing. Now, although the customer is the hero, maybe we are also heroes, because the hero is a classic archetype. And so heroes do band together. Heroes assemble for success. So you can also reflect your customer a little bit. And so what the hero is all about is building themselves up to overcome some terrible evil. They want to prove themselves through courageous action. We go to the hero to get us through, to help fight that evil and overcome it. So you've got like all the DC comics and Marvel comics, you know, example, Wonder Woman there, that's such a classic archetype. And from a brand perspective, Nike, it just helps us overcome, helps us push through the pain. And they often position themselves by looking at the heroic sports people of our time. What about the innocent? I love the innocent. You go to the innocent because they give you faith and optimism. They're always super positive. Can be slightly naive, but sometimes we just need someone to be positive, don't we? So they're all about being happy, experiencing paradise. You can think of Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz or Belle in Beauty and the Beast. Innocent smoothies, I don't know if that's across the world, but here in the UK, it's like a smoothie drink, and everything about it is good and good for you. What about the jester? The jester is an archetype that lives in the moment, is always joyful and fun, and obviously makes us laugh. If you can think of Jack Sparrow in Pirates of the Caribbean as a classic example. Ben and Jerry's is a great example of a jester brand. You know, they don't take themselves too seriously. So look at their ingredients. They're a big dollop of this, a big dollop of that. So, you know, quite good fun. And, you know, a lot of these jester brands, M&M's, for example, they might articulate themselves with cartoons and very entertaining and jokes and fun. What about the lover? The lover brand is one that's all about connecting the audience with a real deep sense of relationship. So they want to draw close to the people they're trying to attract. they want to be in a deep relationship with them and share. You know, I did some work for a furniture company, and we decided we were the lover archetype. And it was all about the grain of the furniture and really the soft furnishings, and really want people to fall in love with the product that we were selling. So obviously fictional examples, Romeo and Juliet, Jack Dawson and Titanic. Haagen-Dazs is a good example of an ice cream that really presents itself in that sort of lover way. The next one's the magician, which is all about transformation and change and being the catalyst for change. So you've got the genie in Aladdin, for example, or Tabasco sauce. You put a few drops on your soup and it's not soup, it's an atom bomb, you know? Magic, exactly, Rachel. I love that. So there's a little bit of pixie dust going on. What about the rebel, right? Somebody put this in one of their whys, I think. It was quite good to rebel. So the rebel is all about change, but not like the magician, which is like transformation and sort of doing that in a kind of a magical way. The rebel wants change and they want it now, and they're going to fight for it, and they're going to shake their fist at the world and cause a bit of a revolution. So you can think of Han Solo in Star Wars, like everyone's going one direction. Hans is going in the other direction, like just because he's a rebel. And I've put BrewDog there, but a great example is Liquid Death at the moment. They're a massive brand. They're really shaking things up in America. They're water in a can and they're just breaking all the rules. Like, how can you call water in a can liquid death? It just makes no sense. But they're rebelling against a number of things, against plastic and so on. And so it's super powerful. Couple more now. So we got the sage. Sages are the gatekeepers of wisdom and knowledge. So you can think of Yoda. You go to Yoda to find out about the Force. You go to The Economist to learn more, to become more than a trainee. You go to Wikipedia or Google to learn more. So they're the sages of our world. And the last one is the ruler. So rulers are all about control. And so they want to create a successful tribe, and they want to do so, they want to remove chaos and that kind of thing. And they want to bring order into the world. And so they lead us forward calmly into the future. So you can think of Aragorn in Lord of the Rings or Rolex that position themselves very much as the pinnacle, the ruler brand in the watch category. So there's our 12 archetypes. I hope you found that interesting. I'm going to jump into the mural in a minute because I'm quite excited to see where we all land. There's one other little thing that I wanted to add, because a lot of people just kind of think that you can use those tools and anything can happen. But really, if you go through Margaret Mark and Carol S. Pearson's book, the value in what they did was that they deployed motivational theory to these archetypes. And so what they found was that particular archetypes appeal to particular customers who are motivated to do some very core things. So, for example, some of the questions is worth asking is, do you help people belong and have a relationship? Or do you help people feel safe and stable? Do you help people become independent and realize their self-actualization? Or do you help people achieve mastery and esteem? Because these are four key kind of elements of human motivation. And Margaret Mark and Carol S. Pearson suggest, they don't say it's dictatorially this, but you see in the middle of this circle here, that in safety and stability, for example, the best archetypes to show up for customers or to show up for people to really fulfill that are the caregiver, the creator, and the ruler. For independence, you've got the sage, innocent, and explorer. For mastery and esteem, the hero, the rebel, and the magician. And for belonging in relationships, you've got the jester, the lover, and the citizen. Now, as I say, this isn't a science per se. And what I find is although it's grounded in science and psychology, the real value of this tool is to get leadership teams usually aligning around where they think they sit and how that works. So workshop time. We're going to cut this much shorter. Let me get into mural there. Get in there. It's just warming up. Find your little card again. Oh, hang on. Okay. Interesting. Find your card again. And give me your number one priority primary archetype. Which one leapt out and said, I'm definitely that? And if you were struggling to select just one, pick a secondary archetype, because sometimes that's how you can get a really interesting blend and depth and meaning to where you're going. And I think that can be really, really helpful. The other thing I was going to ask you
And don't forget to screenshot your square at this point, too, if you'd like that. Mm-hmm.
Great shout, Rach. Great shout. The other thing I was going to suggest is if you get a moment, try and think of some reasons. Why did you choose the magician? Why did you choose the rebel? What was it about that and about the things that you wrote in your why, who, and what that you felt was correct? And as I say, you know, we could spend a long time doing this. Hopefully, you know, we're just playing now. Is not, you know, it's not set in stone. Please don't stress too much about it. It's a bit of fun. But hopefully you'll see how useful this is.
And how long do you want for this? Do you want to set a quick timer?
I do. I'm going to set, let's set 2 minutes. How do I do that, Rach?
I got it.
You got me. And this is why I need you.
I'm going to do it without music, though, so you could talk during it. So
That sounds good. So, oh, by the way, the way that I want you to select this, I didn't explain, is to select the little number one. You'll see that there's a little coin to the right hand side of the circle where all the archetypes are. Pick on your number one and move that to your primary choice. And if you do have a secondary, pick on that and move through. I'll just say while you're doing it, one of the interesting things that tends to happen when you do this with a team is that most often there is usually misalignment. And that is why this tool is so powerful, because what can happen is you can say, look, you think you're 8 different archetypes. No wonder customers are confused as to who you are. Because if you can then work with a team to align around one, it makes everybody's job easier. It makes HR's job easier because they can think about how they show up for their people. It makes sales and marketing's job a little easier. It makes operations and products job a little easier because you can see yourselves collectively as a key archetypal figure in the customer's journey. And that's why it's super strategic and exciting. So really good. So I can see, Matt, you've put on there. Let's have a look. The magician. I like that. Good to see you, by the way, Matt. I can see who else we've got. We've got Kreiser. She's the rebel. Nice work. Love a good rebel. Thought you might be. Matt Wright, we've got a magician as well. Matt, nice. I hope I've said this right. Kumail is the caregiver, loving that. Anu has gone with the citizen, the voice of reason. She's put there, I like construction arguments. I love constructive arguments, I think that means. Fantastic. Someone's hedged their bets. Charla, I love that. Hedged your bets between caregiver and creator. I think that's a sort of an in-betweener. And then there's another one between, is that what you've done, or magician and explorer? So that's smart. There we are. Right. Well, time's up on that one. And I hope you found that interesting. And I'm really appreciative of all the people that have put their reasons in there as well. That's been super. Let me just move that back there. Because you can see that it really starts to help, you know, you articulate the meaning you want to you want people to start attaching to you. If I can get my tongue. Erica says, so hard. I don't remember all of them. I know. Sorry. We've only got an hour together, so I've had to really whiz through that.
But this was recorded for Matt to see. Yeah. His wonderful knowledge will be recorded and provided afterwards. So you can go back to it.
Yeah. Nice. A couple of thoughts. I'm going to bounce us off this just so that we do finish on time. And if you do have any questions, I'm happy to hang around a little bit afterwards. I don't know if that's allowed, Rachel, but I'm more than happy to. And if not, reach out to me. But what hopefully you've seen with that is how powerful it is. And I should have probably given a little health warning before, because what will happen now is that you'll begin to be able to categorize any advert you see, any billboard you pass, any sort of new website you hit. You'll be able to see where the strategic application of that is beginning to come from in terms of the archetype. So I drive my wife absolutely nuts because I'm like, yeah, Explorer brand, Sage brand, Citizen brand, whatever. So really helpful, I think, to align teams and to give you kind of a focus and a framework to begin to manage your meaning as you see yourself as that type of character in the customer's story. But there's other things you can use archetypes for. So you can, for example, look at the competitors in your space and kind of see archetypally, where are they sitting? And then, as we know, the human brain notices what's different. So is there an opportunity to maybe flex into a different archetype and really position yourself differently amongst the competition? You can also think about, okay, well, if I am this archetype, who are my customers? And some businesses have multiple customers, right? So sometimes it's helpful to think about, well, we're serving rulers and we're serving sages, but we're going to show up as the citizen for them. People come out of my workshops talking about all sorts of bizarre stuff. Who knows? But, you know, you see what I mean? It kind of can help you think through the way that your persona, the persona of your audience ticks and gives you a common language to talk about that. If you have partners and you're trying to manage supply chains, for example, again, you can think and apply archetypes to those as well. And I think the other thing is although you might be a particular type of archetype, they're neither good or bad. Like there's dark sides to each of the archetypes. But if you think about who's the villain in the story, like what's the big crisis that's coming? What's the evil? And if you can document that, sometimes that can be an archetypal character as well. It can be super helpful. So hopefully you can see you can really use this tool. The biggest thing I would say, if we've got any designers in the room and creatives or anyone that manages marketing campaigns or product, is that once you've got an archetype, you see, you can layer into it, layer meaning into it. People say, oh, don't you think, well, then all the brands will be the same? Well, no, because there's multiple different types of magician archetype. There's lots of different types. You can show up differently. If you're the hero, there's different ways the hero can show up. It gives you a kickstart, though, and it gives the team a start to align around. And then you can develop on top of that. So what are the traits that we would associate, the characteristics with our particular version of the sage, for example? And then from that, once you align around, you know, five or six traits, you can then deploy that into things like, okay, what are our principles for our look and feel of our brand? Or our tone of voice, the way that we speak, our messaging. And ultimately, how will that work its way out into the brand experiences? So one of the hardest things I think creatives have is trying to show the level of thinking that takes them from a strategic direction, from perhaps a boardroom or a strategist, and take that out into actually, well, now I'm going to create, you know, some social media posts or a social media campaign. How do I explain why I've made these decisions? And so if you've got an archetype in play, it can really help you say, look, we are using this language because we are the magician and we're about transformation. And in this particular aspect of the product, the thing that transforms customers is going to transform their lives is this feature. So we've honed our whole campaign around this amazing transformation feature, and we are using magical language and so on and so forth. So it really helps you kind of develop that. Now, I'm coming to the end of my time. So I wanted to say, look, think in stories. That's how we all think. That's how customers think. Steve Jobs, it wouldn't be the same, wouldn't it, without a quote from Steve Jobs. He said once, apparently it was reported, someone overheard him say this in a canteen, so I'm not sure how true it is, but apparently he once says the most powerful person in the world is the storyteller. So my parting message to you is think about your personal brand, think about your business brand, think about your customers' brands. Manage the meaning carefully, and hopefully you've seen that archetypes are such a powerful way to do that. If you want to connect with me, I love connecting with people, so I'm massively active on LinkedIn. Jump on LinkedIn. As Rach says, I've got a bit of a book, I've got a podcast, so check those out. The final thing I was going to say was this is quite a new announcement, so relatively new, so you might be interested in this. I do run a mastermind. We are accepting applications at the moment. I know some of the mastermind are on, so hi, guys. If you were interested in joining a community that is basically around brand building and brand management in all sorts of different fields, we've got copywriters, we've got strategists, we've got designers, agency folks, freelance folks, in-house, corporate, whatever. If you want to join a community, we'd love to have you come on board. Check that out. You've got to apply, and I'll review your application. That would be wonderful. And if you could mention somewhere in the application you connected with me through Butter, I'll see if I can give you something a little special on the way through. So that's me. I mean, that was a whirlwind, Rach. I got there in time.
It was.
I
was nervous at some point,
but hopefully
I'm going to pull up this poll just for anyone who wants to share with you what's an insight or two or three that they learned today. Feel free. You can add as many as you want in separate answers here. I've got some people asking about recording. Yes, the recording will be available. We also post recaps of these in the Butter community. So feel free to join the Butter community. It's free. We've got some pinned messages there. Matt, I have pinned a multitude of questions for you, so maybe we can get you back for an async AMA in the Butter community with some of those. We'll talk about that. So feel free to drop any additional questions in the chat if you'd like, and share with us what insights that you learned. Matt, if you go ahead as a facilitator and click I have no answer, you should see everyone else's answers.
Oh, awesome. This is great. Thank you so much, folks. Really appreciate you, you know, you coming as well and your thoughts. There's a couple of questions here, though, that I think I hopefully have answered. Is it good time to stay on, Rach, for 5 minutes and deal with that? Or would you prefer we close and do it another time?
Unfortunately, I don't think we could stay much longer here. Maybe about 2 to 3 minutes if you want to take one.
Okay, yeah, so Mick asks, so we're the mentor, and our mentor archetype is how we help the hero and how we support them. A quick answer to that is yes. Matt Wright asked, I'm going to take two because I'm a rebel. How would you do this with multiple stakeholders? How do you drive alignment around a specific archetypal mix? That's super, super good question. Really tricky. I would actually suggest one way to do it is to literally get them all in a scenario like this, if that's possible, and do that. If not, you have to do multiple groups and then kind of aggregate up into one that you as the strategist would recommend back to the company. So that's how I would probably take that one, Matt, but I'd have to know the specific circumstances, but hopefully that's useful. All right. Well, that's it then, really. I think, Rach, thanks so much, everybody. What a whirlwind. It's been great. It's been awesome. Thank you. Keep managing your meaning, and look forward to connecting with some of you outside of this. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone.